Azure functions are great, and we learn already a lot about that, but sometimes it could be hard to get started. So do you have any advice for us?
Yeah, you're right, Frank, 100%. Sometimes whenever using a new service, it can be daunting and even difficult to figure out the best path forward and how to get ramped up. So today we're going to talk about a few things such as plan selection, when to use bindings, and additional best practices today. The first decision that you're going to have to make with Azure Functions is what hosting model you want to go with and what plan. So whenever people ask me about this, I always recommend using the consumption model first. So consumption is our fully serverless plan. You only pay for what you use, and it's great at handling automatic scale at high load with unpredictable loads and traffic. So you're getting a lot of greatness that Functions has, and for most people, this is going to be perfect for your scenarios. Now, for some folks, you're going to need some additional capabilities as well. And this is when the Functions Premium plan comes in. So for example, if low latency is really important, customers are going to a web page and you want that to load super fast, the Premium plan is going to be really good for that. In service land, there's a thing called cold start. This is really prevalent in consumption when going from 0 to 1 instances. In Premium plan, we get rid of that because we give you instances that are always ready. In addition, you might be looking for some additional features and capabilities, such as VNet integration. You want to be completely isolated within a virtual network, or if you want to lock down your endpoints, you're going to need to use Premium plan over consumption in high load scenarios there. In addition, depending on the workloads you have, Premium plan might actually save you some money versus consumption. The consumption plan is charged based on executions, while the Premium plan is based on the number of instances that you have. So if you have a really large number of small executions, the Premium plan would also be the way to go. Now, just a couple more plans. So the app service plan, if you really need predictive load and cost, then this would make sense for you. In addition, if you already have existing web apps that are using app service plans as well, you can sort of share some of that cost with the function apps and use the same plans again. And finally, Kubernetes, sometimes you're going to be using functions and you might be using with additional clouds. So example, AWS or GCP, Kubernetes offers a lot of flexibility here in doing multi-cloud solutions. And in addition to that, it's really great for integration with on-prem.
That's pretty cool. I love that. Like there's a plan for kind of every situation. So now I have my plan. What's next? What should I focus on?
Yeah, for sure. So the next thing is where you want to do your development. So the portal is really great for trying things out and sort of kicking the tires, but if you want to really dive deeper into functions, you should set up your local development experience because it'll really help you out in the long run and offer you a lot more capabilities. So one really great tool for local development that I just pulled up here is VS Code. And if you're using VS Code, you want to make sure that you have the Azure Functions VS Code extension. And when you have a VS Code extension installed, your environment will look a lot like this and provide additional capabilities. So for example, if you want to add functions, add a binding, do deployment, it's a lot easier.
That's pretty cool. And is there any best practices? What will you suggest us about triggers and like how can we make sure we do it the right way?
Yeah, for sure. So for triggers and bindings, they're really cool. They're really great for integrating with other services. For triggers, you always want to use the Azure Functions triggers versus the SDK, just because we do a lot for you in terms of scaling and the capabilities there. However, for bindings, if you're doing read and write workloads for your integration services, it would make a lot of sense to use input and output bindings just because they offer so much in terms of making it easier for your development experience. In addition, you can have multiple bindings per trigger. So for example here, I have an HTTP trigger set up, service bus output binding, storage queue output binding. And you can see like how easy it is in terms of just using these additional bindings. So for output bindings for service bus and storage queues, it's just that piece of code and this piece of code right here, as well as a little bit in a function.json. And this will allow me to basically send information once my function triggers with HTTP trigger to the service bus and storage queue.
Pretty cool. So like then like we do that and would can we add more kind of advice for the long term? Because, you know, sometimes like it's pretty easy to get started and then like
a month after
we're all messed up.
Yeah, for sure. One thing that you really want to keep in mind is, you know, how functions and function apps and plans relate. So you can see here that I have three different functions that are all different triggers for this function app. And, you know, for example, maybe let's say I have like a lot of HTTP traffic. I'm getting a lot of requests to my website, right? And I'm going to need more instances to scale out and use that. This service bus queue trigger, since it's also on the same function app, it'll also scale out to the same number of instances and be sharing those resources, right? So that's just something to be mindful of.
Oh, interesting, interesting. Okay, so like we saw the best practices and everything, but what if, you know, things don't go always as we expect? How can we monitor that?
Yeah, for sure. So we actually provide a lot of great tools in Azure Functions. So for example, if you go to a portal right here, right? Let's say you've been debugging your function app. You're, you know, going through reading the documentation, trying things out, nothing's working, you know, doesn't seem like there's great advice. What you can do is you can actually go to this diagnose and solve blade for your function app in a portal. And if you click on these different areas, right, we'll actually offer you a lot of insight into where you might be having issues. So for example, let's say function cold start is like a big issue for your function app. You could come here, go to function cold start, and we'll pull up these things that we have detectors, which are things that we run against your app to find, you know, common issues that people usually run into. So here you can see that my app, I can see, you know, I'm already on a premium plan. That's great for cold start. Yeah, just, you know, make sure you check the notes below. We'll have the links for all of these to learn more about, you know, plans, best practices, everything here.
Perfect. Thank you.